It off. Oh, got it recording. Perfect. So I'm going to walk you guys through all the different ways that you can use Ruskin 10. And then I'm going to show you my infamous, the Alex. Now with all my techniques, I name them after my clients. So specifically today I'm teaching the Alex, and the Alex, she is a client that comes to see me every 10 to 12 weeks. She's a brunette. She doesn't want lightener in her hair, but she doesn't want that flat brunette color. She also doesn't want to have roots that show up. She's very particular with it. And so what I've created for her is I created using Ruskin 10, and I hand paint it into her hair. And I'll show you on my mannequin, I painted the same formula, same everything that I use on her. You can also go onto my Instagram, and anything that you see, the Alex, it's the same technique that I'm going to be showing you guys here today. First, I'm going to go through a little bit of product knowledge on Ruskin 10. And then after I go through some product knowledge, I'm going to go through my hand painting tools, what you're going to want, what you're going to need. Then I'll show you the placement. And like Ashley said, if you guys have any questions, use the chat, especially once I get to the hands-on portion. If you guys can't see it well, let me know. I'm going to put it right in front of me so you guys can see me hand painting it. So let's get started. Let me grab my Ruskin 10. So this is the color swatch for Ruskin 10. And what I love about this is Rusk came out with their new color book. So here's their color book. It's smaller, it's easier to hold. And what you can do is when you come into their swatch book, you literally can go through and pick out what you need. I pulled out the insert for the Ruskin 10. This guy usually lives in here, but there's a ton of beautiful colors in here as well. Okay, so we have our Ruskin 10 and we have our swatches right here. Now, one thing I want you guys to know, Ruskin 10, just because it's 10-minute color, does not mean that it's just for root coverage or all over color. I want you to be creative and think outside the box. Like when Rusk brought me on as their Ruskin 10, for a second I was like, all right, so what more can we do than just a root touch up with Ruskin 10? Let's turn this into a full permanent color line in my studio because I don't have much storage here. So all the Ruskin 10 has replaced all my permanent color in the studio. And knowing how to mix it and use the different levels, that has made it ideal to completely take over. So first we're gonna start with the mixing ratios for Ruskin 10. I get asked this a lot. So today I'm gonna be doing a 1-to-1 mix ratio. That's just because I'm gonna be hand painting. When I hand paint with it, I want it to have that thicker consistency. But knowing when you're doing your mix ratios, so if you have your 1-to-1, 1-to-2, you could even do 1-to-3, 1-to-4. So the 1-to-1, that's gonna be my strongest solution right there. It's gonna be bright, it's gonna be powerful. 1-to-1 is also what I use for those grays that do not want to cover. It's high impact right there. Next step is gonna be a 1-to-2. 1-to-2 is your normal all over color. It's your kind of your go-to, and that's going to be cost-wise. It's going to save you the most because you're using more developer than color. Then we can also use Ruskin 10. We can shear it out more and turn it into not a demi, but it'll have the demi appearance. So you could do like a 1-to-3. I use the 1-to-3 when I'm doing like a shadow root. So you put on your highlights, you rinse your highlights, and then you want to have that nice soft root. That's when I will mix 1-to-3. Any questions on mix ratios? Because I do get asked about mixing a lot, and I want to make sure that we're clear on how you mix it and what you mix it with. No questions. I like it. Okay. So next up is the developers, your volumes with Ruskin 10. So Rusk just released their universal developers. So it's these guys right here. Completely, completely game changer with storage for here. They have 0 lift, 10 vol, 20 vol, 30 vol, and 40 vol. You can use all the developers with Rusk and 10. So don't be afraid to use them all. I play with all of them. And then for using for gray coverage, because I know this is what first 10-minute color was used for. So I want to make sure that I can talk about gray coverage and what developers you can use. So say you have that client that is super resistant, they're a level 5, and you have a really hard time covering their grays, and you're like, how is this 10-minute color gonna work? I will reach for my 0 or my 10 volume. Remember that you get your lift in your tuba color and not your developer. When I use those lower developers, it's not gonna develop that pigment and that color too fast. It's gonna allow it to have time to open up the cuticle, deposit, and you're not gonna have, when you use a higher developer, sometimes it can break up, eat through those pigments. So using that lower developer isn't allowed to have full pigmentation going in. So with gray coverage, try using a 0 volume or 10 volume. I was taught to use 20 volume for all gray coverage, but trust me, it's beautiful. It comes out gorgeous with the gray coverage using a lower developer. The only time that I will use a higher developer for gray coverage is say I'm using like level 8 and up, because those are my brighter ones. It's okay for them to have that. Then next up for developers with using it with Rusk in 10 is when you go to formulate, like for today, for the Alex, I'm gonna be doing a red. I wanna have her bright and vibrant. So I'm gonna be using the 30 volume today. I wanna get as much lift as I can, and I want it to be super bright. So when you're also going to formulate, think of, do they have gray? How much do I want to lift them? Think of the pigmentation that you're wanting to expose and bring out to the hair. So those are the steps that I go through when I'm going, all right, what should be my mix ratio and what developer should I use? Any questions or concerns about developers? Because that's another one. I know it's thrown off a lot of people going, wait, 20 volume, that's for gray coverage. That's what we're all taught in beauty school. So if you have any questions, let me know, because I kind of want to move through so we can get into all the fun stuff. No questions in the chat? Perfect, cool. Okay, so next up with Rusk in 10, you guys, it is pure pigments. What do I mean by pure pigments? Is you're gonna have, let me open this up so I can kind of show you guys. Okay, so we have the natural series. This is, you're gonna have your double N and your N. These guys are gonna have a double brown and yellow. This is what you're gonna use when you're working with gray coverage. And I'll show you why here in a second. So as we open up and we get in to the ash series. So you have the ash series right here, and you're gonna see it's a green, blue, violet. This is literally green and blue, you guys, blue and violet. So if you go to put the 7A on 100% gray, you're not gonna get that coverage. You're not gonna get what you need. So you need to make sure when you're formulating with these pure tones and you're working with gray coverage, that you're adding in the double N or the N series to make sure you get that full coverage there for you. And you're like, well, what? There's only a 5NN, 7NN. Mix the ratio. So it's gonna make you think, which is really good. So, you know, you could mix a 5NN and a 7NN, you're gonna get a 6NN. You can also use the NNs as like an anchor. If you wanna add just a ribbon into your formula, that's gonna help give you really beautiful coverage when you're needing it as well. So let's look into more of the colors that you have here. So they have the Ash series. The Sand series is one of my favorite because it's so balanced. You have yellow, violet, and blue. It's a very balanced series. I love, one of my favorite formulas that I will use for my level 8s or my 7s is I will use the 8S and then I'll mix it in with the 7N. That's gonna give you a beautiful, beautiful color for those stubborn grays at those lighter levels. Then we're gonna come here, we have the gold series. And as you can see right here at the top, it says yellow, that's gonna be your gold. And then you have your copper, copper gold series, orange, orange, yellow. I don't need to go through everything, but today what we're gonna use is I'm gonna use a 6R, and you guys can write this down if you want to. We're gonna do a 1-to-1 mix ratio, and I'm going to do 6R with a 30 vol. Then my little secret sauce is I'm going to add a ribbon of 5M to her formula. When I do this, this just gives it that nice coolness. I don't want to have a too bright of a red. Like, I want it bright and vibrant, but I don't want it that kind of bright warm. So that 5M is going to cool that down for me as well. And then we have the High Lift Ash and the Boost. These guys are amazing. We'll have to talk about these another time because we are concentrating on the Alex and formulating for that. Any questions on any of the pigments, formulation? If you guys get the insert, this whole back, it's a little cheat sheet. It's going to go through everything for you guys, the mix ratio, everything that you need to know with it. This is your go-to. And if you're needing to mix for gray coverage, the back of the swatch book, you're going to find this guy right here. So this is going to be really important to utilize when you're looking into your pigments, what level. It's going to go over your percentage of gray, and then what you should mix with. All right, now I'm excited. Okay, so after you get your whole formula together, did you know you need to pick out the correct tools? So I'm gonna show you guys my painting brushes. This goes for when I'm using lightener and color. Depending on the hair's texture and density is gonna dictate what brush you use. I do not go and just pick out a brush and go, okay, let's paint. You need to think about, first of all, if they have fine hair like angel hair pasta, or if they have spaghetti hair or linguine. And each different texture is going to dictate what brush. So for example, if you have that client that has that like really fine angel hair that like can't hold much, you do not want to go and grab your Power Painter. Why? Because see how thick these brushes are? It's going to hold a lot of product. So if you go to load this up with your color or your lightener, that hair can't support all of that color. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in here. Sometimes I will use this little detail brush. As you guys can see, it's very fine, dainty, and little. You want to look in at all of your brushes and you just want to find the ones that are small and dainty. They're going to hold the least amount of color. You might have to reload and work on that section, but using a light little brush for fine hair is important. Now, when you have that client that has that spaghetti hair, I'm very individual. So they have, it's not that baby fine hair, it's that next level medium hair that you would say. Those guys are really good, your everyday go-to brush. Let me set this down so I don't drop it. So these brushes, they're your typical brush that you see. You do want to make sure when you're painting, you're using the softer bristle so it doesn't have the blunt edge. And I'll show you the blunt edge. So this is what I would use for root touch-ups. See how big this guy is? And he has a blunt edge. This guy for my medium hair, I'm going to use this guy. He's smaller, but he has those kind of just broken up. So it's going to help with your blending. It's going to make sure that you're not ending up with any harsh lines. Using a brush with a blunt end is going to give you harsh lines, even the best painter. Okay. So now we're going to jump up into linguine, that hair that is thick and coarse and can handle it. Sometimes you'll hit this with like medium hair, that medium to coarse. I will use my Power Painters. So Power Painters, like I showed you guys, they have a lot of bristles here and they're super thick. So when you stick it into your color bowl and you pull it up, even when you wipe it off, you're going to have loads of color in there. So making sure, don't use a Power Painter on angel hair, fine hair. You're going to have a hot mess. The Power Painters are really good for that medium coarse hair, the hair that can hold it. And what I'll really know is when I'm holding tension on my section, you can see really the type of hair texture they have and you'll see what it can support. If you grab the wrong brush, you're like, whoa, this is really loading up. Switch brushes, bring over a few brushes till you can figure out which brush will work for you. any question on brushes, because I know it's something that you wouldn't think of, but it's something that is very, very important, especially when you're hand painting, when you're working with color too, because color, it's not as forgiving as lightener and it can be very scary to paint with. So making sure you have the right brush will be important for setting you up for success. Anything in the chat? Am I going too fast for anybody?
Can you say the edge is a thing again? And then Katie, I want to ask you, formula is 6R plus 30 volume plus a ribbon of 5M?
What correct. Did you say?
Okay.
Yep.
I'm going to put it in the chat for everybody. And then you got, you asked, can you go over the edges again?
Yes. So the edges of the brushes. So when we're looking at the brushes, so this is my root brush. So you can see right here, that edge is very blunt. And I have another one I can show you. So they're very blunt, as you can see. Can you guys see the edges? Okay. So then I'm going to grab my normal brush. Now this is a soft brush. So you can see those edges. See how they're not completely straight across. It has a variation where it's going up and down like it's jagged. This is what you want to paint with. For root touch-ups, all over colors, you only want to use these guys, and they're bigger. It's going to save time as well. Yes, variation in the edges is very important to paint with. All right. So moving on. So I'm going to show you guys the half of the head that I've already done. And then I'm going to show you the sectioning. My girlfriend over here, my youngest, Harper, she named her Rachel. So I'm going to show you guys Rachel, AKA we're doing the Alex honors, don't get confused. Okay, so this right here is the formula that I used that I told you today on her. It's beautiful, it's soft. And when we're looking at the roots right here, you can't really see, like when you do foils, you see foil, foil, foil. So it's beautiful. Here's the side that I'm going to work on today. You can see the variation. What's beautiful about hand painting, it's going to give that softness. It's going to look like literally it's growing out of her head. It's not going to have those ribbony foils. And then what I'm going to show you too is see how vibrant these ends are. I completely tip out the ends when I'm doing the ends. So this soft root, this is what you do when you're hand painting with clay lightener, and you're going to get it with your normal color. Very soft, low maintenance, blends into the hair. If you have a client that's wanting to see those bright ribbons at the root, this is not the technique. You don't want to paint with color. Even if you do the biggest, chunkiest pieces, painting is such a soft technique that it just really melts into itself. So, all right, now let me show you guys the sectioning. So when you're doing the sectioning, you can use this sectioning with a lightener application or a Ruskin 10 application. And this application that I'm showing you in this pattern is Express as well. So you can use this with anybody. It's super simple. So first, what we're gonna do is you wanna find their part. If they're a flipper from right to left, do middle, use the part, and make sure you tell them that you need to know where they part most often if they have a dominant one, because when you paint on that dominant part, that's when it's gonna fall really pretty and that's when it's important. But if they do flip a lot, put it in the middle, you're gonna have that evenness no matter what side they part and switch it to, okay? All right, so what our sectioning is going to be is we have front hairline back to under the crown. This is one section, you guys. And that's going to be on this side too. So when I come over to this side of her head, I'm going to make sure that I'm sectioning down below the crown, because we're wanting to make sure we get the back side of the head and the front side of the head. And when you're working through these sections, you're not going to be going back and forth between the head. You're going to section this section. You're going to paint all this. Then you're going to come to this side, use this section and paint all this side. This is what's going to cut down on your time, is having less sections. You're not having to completely section it out. It's easy peasy, literally two sections. Now, if you want to get fancy or they want a little bit more color to pop down here, that is really easy. So say you have her sectioned up like this. All you're going to do is you're going to grab this lower hair, hand paint it, like freehand it. Do not be like, it has to be perfect. It has to be parted. Come through and see where this is hanging and you're just going to paint it. And I'll show you guys how I do that too, because it's scary, especially with even lightener. It can be a little intimidating to paint underneath and then just let it be because you're scared that it's going to get splotchy. It's going to create a mess. It won't. I will show you guys the underneath. So any questions on the sectioning that I have done for the express application? You guys are a good group today. Good group. Okay. So now I've showed you guys the section. I'm going to show you a mock of how I'm going to work through it before I mix up my color, my tension, my elevation, and then we're going to get in to mixing the color. So what's important too when you're painting is when you're painting with color, you want to think of it just like when you're painting with lightener. You want to use the same tension, the same elevation, making sure your surface is flat, okay? All right, so I'm going to get her set up so you guys can see it. I'm going to put the camera right in front of me. While I'm setting this up, any questions? Am I moving at a good pace for everybody? Okay. So don't mind me, I am going to flip around my camera. Okay, you guys are gonna see outside, bear with me. All right, gonna tour of my studio at the same time. All right, so there she is. All right, so I have my front hairline to lower back section right here. So when we're working through, we're gonna be working through in a forward diagonal back. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my section, and how thick you take the section dictates on how their hair density is. So if someone had really fine hair, I'm going to take a bigger section. If they have a ton of hair, I may take a smaller section. So make sure you're aware of how big your sections are going to be depending on how thick, coarse or fine their hair is. She has a medium density, so I'm going to work with just like my average sections. And what I'm going to do, so we're going to do this forward, diagonal, back. All right. So when I have her clipped up, you can see as we're working up the head, it's going to cover from the front hairline. I'm going to move this over so you guys can see better. Back to the back. And this is also the moment when you do your first section right here, this is the great time to be able to grab and paint under here as well. So when you start to paint your first front section, if their back section needs to be done, do these guys together. Do not wait to do this section once you're all the way up at the top and done, because you're not going to be able to get underneath here, because you're going to see all this hair is going to fall over and you're just not going to have access to it. So do these together, super important right there. All right, so now what I'm going to show you guys is when I start painting, I want to make sure that all my sections are smooth. So I'm going to make sure it's combed flat. You want to have a flat, smooth surface. If you have bumps in it, it's going to be splotchy. That's when you get those splotches. Now, when I'm working down a section and I'm painting, you can start to get like little bumps as you're working. So the best way that I'm going to do to smooth them out is they're kind of like scissor fingers. I'm going to take my finger and I'm just going to brush it out like this. And you guys will know what I'm talking about once I'm getting into painting. I just want to take the time to show you guys some of my tips and tricks to make it smoother. So you'll just smooth the hair on your ends just like this, and then you'll pick your brush up and you'll get back to painting. Now, what's going to be important with this technique is your direction. So we're going to over direct back. So see how that's opening up that whole front hairline? So it's going to allow me to get in closer to the hairline. So let me grab a brush and I'm going to mimic what I would do. So say if we just kept it down like this and I brushed on here, it's going to be harder for me to get through this front. I can do it, but you're not going to get that saturation. I'm wanting to make sure I give her that pop in this front area since it's such a soft technique. I want to get as close as I can and as much saturation as well. So what we're going to do is we're going to make sure we over direct it back. Then we'll come in and I'm going to paint. And then I'm using scissor fingers the whole time to help with my tension. And then you're just going to put that section where you want it and we're going to paint up. Now, something cool that you can do too with this technique is elevating it up and painting underneath. So what if you want to paint this underneath, because you want to make sure that this is all super bright. So what you're going to do is comb your section. I always comb every section, elevate it up. And what you can see, so see where my fingers are? That's where I'm going to stop painting at. And then that's when I'm going to drop it down. So I'll come through from wanting to paint this underneath. I'm going to paint the underneath. And you're like, well, what are you going to do from here to here? Well, I'm going to drop it down. See how I'm using those fingers, the scissor fingers, smooth it down. Then we're going to paint all this. Then you're going to use a paddle. And when you use the paddle and you work through these ends, that's what's going to give you that cohesive brightness from underneath and top. So once again, if you want to paint and have this bottom part bright, do this first, elevate it all the way up, nice and smooth. And then as you drop it, scissor fingers are what is going to smooth out all of your sections for you. Okay, so as we move up in her head, I am a very confident painter, but I will subsection sometimes as well. So once we start getting back to this farther part of the head, back into the crown section, that's a much bigger section than what you had to handle right here in the front. So a few important things when you get to here. So I'm going to kind of reach back. So we're in a really deep section. Okay. So when you're working with a really big section like this, first of all, she's a mannequin, so she doesn't have any growth patterns. But you know, a lot of your clients will especially have growth patterns right back here in the crown area. So what I like to do is I'm working through this section. You know, when you comb the hair to part it to see where their part is. So that's what you're going to do when you're working with such a wide section like this in your painting. Push up the hair and see where it parts. And even on this mannequin, she parted. And I have three different sections. So that's how I'm going to paint it. And when you start your painting, you're going to start from back to front. If we started from front and I'm over directing and dropping this, you're not going to be able to get to these guys. So start from the back crown area and work your way forward when you're painting. Any questions on that, you guys? Cool. Okay. So then we're just going to work up in a forward diagonal back. We're going to just keep sectioning. Now, let me angle her head so you guys can see the top of her head. When everyone gets to the top, they get kind of confused. Now, this is going to be super important when we get to the top. Can we back this out for you guys? All right. So when you get to the top and you have this side and this side, you want to make sure visually. So say this side I've completely painted. I want to make sure visually I'm looking back and forth and I'm matching them as close as I can. So if I'm feathering and doing a full root up here, I want to make sure that this side is matching it as well. I don't want to come through here and start at the mids and just like give her super rooted and this side not match. So once you get to these top end sections, when I'm at this very last section, when I get right here, I'm going to look to the other side of the head that I've completed. And I'm going to make sure that I mimic what I did over here. If you haven't done this side and you're working on this side, don't worry about it. It's once you finish one side, kind of give it a glimpse and double check. Just like when you're cross-checking a haircut, you want to cross-check as you're hand painting that these sections, you know, you're taking consistent sizes, that you're painting. I like to keep track. For Alex, we're going to be doing full panels. So full panels, it's really easy to make sure that you're keeping track this way. A full panel, what is that? A full panel is going to be this full entire section, okay? So I'm going to make sure I'm painting all this, all the way up. Now, if you want to add more depth and dimension, then you can do a half panel, like rooted out. So you just paint up to here. Then there's a slant where you have the high point here and it slants back. So if you start getting creative and doing more than just full panels, what I like to do is I go, okay, so this section, we're going to do a slant. This one is your very first one that you're starting. So I need to remember when I get to the other side that I'm going to do a slant on her as well. When I start that first section, then when I go to my next section, if I'm doing a tip out, I'll do tip out. So I kind of get in this rhythm and pattern as I'm working up where I'll do slant, mid, full. And I remember that pattern as much as I can. So when I get to the other side, I can mimic it. What I ran into when I was a baby stylist hand painting was I would overpaint one side and I wouldn't have consistent depth and dimension from one side to the other. So keeping track as much as you can of what your pattern is working through, if you're not doing like full panels, something super easy, or at least remember what your first one is and what your last one is. So when it drapes over and they pull it up, you're gonna have that cohesive look going on. Okay, I'm gonna flip you guys back around to me. Moved around. All right, any questions with anything that I just went over with her section before I start to mix up for you guys? All right. You guys are a quiet group today. Pipe up. Like, honestly, if you have any questions in regards to any hand painting, now is the time to ask. Okay. So when you're mixing your color, I sometimes, if my scale has the batteries run out, or if I'm in my home creating content and I don't have my scale, I want to show you guys a few little tips and tricks that you will use to help make sure that if you don't have everything with you, the tools that come with Ruskington or any hair color, essentially, you can look for it. So I'm going to open up. So I'm going to show you guys the 5M. So when you open up your color, when you look on these sides of your color, you're going to see that it's going to have milliliters on one side and ounces on the other. Now, when you look at this color bowl, this looks like just a traditional color bowl. But when you look at the bottom of the bowl, I know it's hard to see here, it's going to have these numbers and it's going to count up. So that's going to be your milliliters. So if you're doing a ribbon, one ribbon across is going to be 5 milliliters. Any questions on that? So when I add ribbons, I'm not just like, oh, a ribbon and putting in a ribbon. It's actually an amount that you're wanting to weigh out, and it's going to be 5 milliliters. Make sure you guys can see me good. Okay, so that is the measuring on the side of the tubes. Now, when you look into the bowl on the sides, up on the sides, you're going to have your ounces, and then you're going to have your milliliters on each side. So when you're pouring in your developer, you can see exactly where it's going and make sure that it's consistent. So it's not anything crazy, but I want to make sure I go over the basics because this little stuff, some people aren't aware of. So I think it's really important to go over. All right. Then next up with Ruskin 10 color, when it's sealed and has not been open yet, so I'm pretty sure this one hasn't, its lifespan is a full life. So it can sit in your storage space, wherever you need it to, as long as it's a good recommended temperature and it's good for a lifetime. Once I crack and open that seal, it's 2 years, right, Ashley? I just want to make sure. 2 years. Okay. So make sure when you're working with your color that you're keeping an eye on ones that you open so you can make sure you're keeping it nice and strong and you're going to get consistent results. All right. Now we're going to mix. So let me move this over. Doing online, I have a love-hate relationship. I feel like I'm always moving everything around to make sure you guys can see. So if you can't see, let me know. I'm gonna bring over my color tray. Make sure you guys can see it. Okay. bring it over to the color tray to you guys. So here's my color tray, and over here, scale. I'm a big one on always making sure that I use my scale. I feel like that is the only way you can make sure when you're remixing, you're gonna get the correct results, especially when you're mixing for gray formulae. If you're not getting that coverage, make sure you're mixing. And also, like a little side tip with your gray coverage, if you're not getting the coverage you want, it's either an absorption issue or a penetration issue. So you need to make sure you assess those guys when you are working with the Ruskin 10. Are you using the right levels, developers for the penetration, absorption? So make sure you're going through those to make sure you get that. I know that's like a side note, but it just hit my head. I throw those out there. Okay. So let me get these guys up. We're gonna start mixing with my 6R. So here's the 6R. Now with Rusk, literally all of their reds are gorgeous. And I'm not just saying that because, you know, I'm a Ruskin 10 specialist. Their reds, like they pop. That's why you see a lot of reds in their campaigns. It is how they formulate it is just butter. It's gorgeous. All right, so let's turn this guy on. And with the Ruskin 10, I want you guys to know too, you can leave it on longer. It's not gonna get dark on you. So if I'm using my Ruskin 10 to say I'm balayaging with lightener and I want a low light, I can use my Ruskin 10. Use the one you wanna use and it's not gonna turn black on you. Just let it set there. So do not be afraid of it getting too dark. Now, one thing you do want to keep in mind is Rusk and 10 is an American level. So if you're using European, make sure to drop your levels, okay? There was a question that was just asked in the chat. I didn't get to see it.
It is the Rusk and 10 difference mainly the processing time compared to other color lines?
Yes, so the Rusk and 10 it's just cutting down your processing time. Now there's differences, like it has the pure tones and the stuff I went over, but I use Ruskin 10 literally like I do my normal permanent color. I don't change anything up for it. All right, so we put in 20 ounces of the 6R and I'm doing a 1-to-1 mix ratio. However, I'm gonna put in a ribbon of my 5M. And what did I tell you guys? That the 5M, when we're doing a ribbon, it's gonna be 5 milliliters. So I'm doing 20 ounces of 6R. I'm gonna do 20 ounces of my 30 volume. This is how I break it down. So we're gonna put in a ribbon. I'm gonna go right across the top because I know that that little reader's down there, okay. Wipe it off. So if I did 20 ounces of 6R and 20 ounces of the 30 vol, that's great, but we have 5 milliliters. It doesn't seem like a big difference, but I wanna make sure that I'm mixing accordingly. So I'm actually gonna add 25 ounces of developer. So zero this out, pour it in. There we go. Scales can be so finicky. Okay, then another important side note, this is me being very particular, is do not use a brush to mix your color. Use a whisk or a spatula. This is gonna make sure that you're getting everything mixed in, you're getting the pigments, all of it broken down and mixed up together. Because the developer, it needs to have its best friend, which is the tube of color. It's gonna develop those color tones for you once they mix and blend together. Oh yeah, that's a good one. With a lot of other color lines with their 10 minute color, they have a designated 20 volume. With Ruskin 10, when it was first packaged, when it came out, some of you guys may have seen, it was a specific 20 volume that went with the Ruskin 10. that 20 is the exact same 20 volume that's for the universal. So keep that in mind as your Ruskin 10. It's one of the only ones, I believe, that does not have a specific developer with it. You can use your normal 20 volume if that's what you're needing to use, or any of the other developers with it. That's what I love with how versatile it is. And it makes your storage area where you're putting your developers condensed down instead of having to have a ton of different developers for every specific color need that you need. Okay, so I'm gonna move these guys over to my other tray. I'm gonna grab my spatula. We're almost to painting time. It's my favorite. I love to paint, you guys. It is just, it's so fun. It's creative, it's artistic, it's that whole nine yards. Okay, I'm gonna step out of the picture real quick and grab my whisk. Any questions, you guys? Any questions at all? All right, so now I'm gonna just start wixing it. And I'm the same way with my lightener. I don't mix like a crazy person getting in here. I like to mix it just a nice medium mixture, especially when you're mixing up your clay to paint. If you get in here crazy and start mixing, it's going to add way too much air into that. That's the same concept that I go when I'm mixing up my color, is I don't want to crazy mix it because you're going to add a ton of air into it. Even if you're running behind, don't worry, it's 10 minute color, take your time. Another few little things and tips and tricks with Ruskin 10 is I do tone with it. So say you have that 100% gray client that comes in every 4 to 6 weeks, they have 100% color all over their head and you're wanting to bring up their highlights. I'll put the highlights in first and then rinse them out, and then I'll put on their 10 minute color, and then I'll put an all over gloss, Ruskin 10 permanent all over them. And it's gonna give longevity, 10 minutes up and done. And it's this beautiful color melt when you do that. So there's many, many things that you can use it for. It's just kind of thinking outside of the box and having fun with it and not just keeping it as a 10 minute root color. It's a luxury color service that you can add to anything. Okay, remove these guys. I'm gonna step out the screen for a second and grab my foils. This is the one thing I do not like online, as I disappear. So I try to talk to you guys. Okay, so insulators. This is very important. With color, you don't really have to worry about it. Sometimes you guys want to use it to make sure that you're not getting messy with it. I've done this technique where I don't use any foils at all. Sometimes I'll take a foil and I'll place it underneath just to make sure that I'm not getting any color on them. You can also think of your insulators. So you have open air, mesh, plastic, and foil. So if you're using this technique and you're using lightener with your color as well, you need to keep this in mind, okay? Especially with your lightener, if you're painting with the Ruskin 10 and both of them together. So the Ruskin 10, it really doesn't need any insulation except for protection. However, when you have that lightener, if you're doing open air, think of open air hand painting where you're not putting any insulation on it as a 10 volume. It's just, it's gonna give it a soft little brightness. Then we have our mesh. So mesh has that airflow that allows to go through it. So your lightener isn't gonna dry out like that, like it does with open air, because once that lightener dries out, it's done working. So that's why open air is a softer technique. That's for your client that just wants 1 to 2 levels of lift, nothing crazy. When you use the mesh, it's keeping that lightener from drying out super quick, but it's still allowing that air. It's a little bit slower, a little bit softer. Mesh is also a really good option if you're wanting to be eco-friendly and you're painting with just color and you want something to make sure you have that insurance, using that mesh in between, that's a really good option as well. Next up is your film, your plastic. This is what you almost, if you look at my work, I use it all the time. It's A, gonna make sure your lightener, it's not gonna dry out whatsoever. And it's not gonna conduct heat. So it's gonna allow it to really just develop low and slow like a good pot roast. So plastic, it's very versatile. It's going to stick. It's my favorite to work with. I love to use, I don't have it over here right now. It's the Framar. They have theirs where you can like literally cut it to the size that you need. Game changer. So then with foils, foils are super fun. I love to fold them up, change them up, play with them, because you can really make a foil fit the head. If say it's a cold day outside, I have a massive window in here. I will sometimes use my foils with this just because it's going to hold in the heat from their head and just keep it happy and processing. You don't use heat with Ruskin 10. Don't. You don't need to use it. You don't need to use it with a lightener. I am a big one that like, just don't use heat. It's not recommended. Don't use it at all. Use their body heat. So that's why using the foils, if you're hand painting too, if you're hand painting on somebody who's really dark and you need to get up there and get that lift, you can still hand paint. You don't need a foliage. Just use the foils on them and that's going to conduct the heat. If you need a little bit more extra heat, place a towel over their head and then take a blow dryer and heat it up just enough so you have everything heated. All right. Time to paint. So I'm going to get everything situated for you guys so you can see it. Did you guys like when I had the camera facing and you're in front of me? Or would you guys prefer if I stand next to her and paint? Put in the chat, somebody. Do you want it in front or do you want me next to her? Just so I can make sure you guys can see visually the best way for you guys. Come on. If you don't pick, I'm going to pick. No choices. Oh, in front. All right. In front it is. Okay. So I'm going to get this all in front of me and get reset up again. So you guys are going to get a little quick tour of my studio again. Might get a little dizzy. And we're going to get her resectioned out here. And another important thing, you guys, is when I, before I start to paint on any client, I tell them to resist my pull, especially when you're on the side of the head. When you're pulling and you have that tape tension, they all go like this. So I tell them resist my pull. And then if we're like in a full conversation, I also disclose this. I'm like, okay, so when I'm painting your head, make sure you resist my pull. And if we're chatting up a ton and you feel me tap your head or move it, that just means put it back. And they're all really good. You need to keep that tension. Tension, tension, tension is so important so that you don't get color from the top of that surface to seep down. So keeping it nice and tight in there. And all of them love that tension. All right. So now I'm going to section her up real quick while I'm sitting here trying to think of anything else. Yes. And I'm going to also be working with a balayage board. I don't have a specific one. I use a ton of different ones. If you are a visual painter and you really want to make sure you can see what you're doing, I don't have it here because I just used it at my content color track. They have a clear balayage paddle. You guys have probably seen me work with it. When you're painting with it, you can see through. And then when you lift it up, you can see underneath. So that's a really good way to make sure that you're getting all that saturation and coverage. Okay. So if you guys need to readjust or anything while I'm moving it around, you gotta take a quick potty break, go for it right now while I am getting set up because I wanna make sure I have her in a good position for everybody to see. And if you guys can't see, let me know.
You guys can feel free to write any questions in the chat if you have.
Yes, any questions you have, let me know. I think I have it good to turn around. Here, I'm going to show you guys my big pretty window. Isn't that thing massive? I love it. It's pretty.
No wonder you get such good content. You got some
right? And it's perfect because it's always indirect light. So I don't have like the direct sun coming in here.
Yeah. So we have, what was the brand of the balayage board you used, Katie?
Sorry. Color Track. So that's the one that I use when I want to see through it. It's literally a clear one. That one is really nice if you're just starting out to hand paint or you're worried about saturation. That's a good one.
Is today, it AREK or AK? I'm sorry.
It's AK.
Okay. There you go.
Yep. And then today I'm actually going to be using this guy. This is from Mars new board that they came out with. As you can see, I've done a lot of reds. It's fall time. This board I like because it is a multi-purpose board. Let me back this up so you guys can see. Isn't that big? It's a really, really big board. So if you're not comfortable holding a big board, don't use it. However, this one, you can foil with it with your teasies. It has this grip right here where you can grip it and it's a little bit more durable. It is a big one. I like this one when I'm painting with color because I have just a really big surface to saturate it down onto. All right, so now let's get this moved up. Can you guys see everything okay? Now that I got everything into position. Perfect. All right, so I'm gonna get even closer on it. And my body position, hold on, I'm gonna try and stand in front of this so you guys can see. So when I'm painting, stand around her, I'm gonna be standing behind because I'm over directing it back. Anytime you're painting, make sure where your body position is and where you're directing it so that you make sure you can get to it easier. I stand in front of them when I'm doing any front stuff. So be aware of your body position and where you're at when you are painting. For today, I'm gonna be standing in a weird, awkward behind, but on a normal basis, woo, I would be right here since I'm over directing back. So that's where you guys would stand. Okay, so let's get to the fun part. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna do our first section. I'm going to do a forward diagonal back. And then I told you guys, when we're doing this first section, you want to do what? You want to make sure that you paint this back one if they want it done as well. So we're going to clip this bad guy out of the way. And let me turn her right here. So I'm going to clip that first section out of the way right there. Then I'm gonna come through. So this is the back hairline section right here that I'm gonna take. So I'm gonna come through, section this side. And when you're working on the back side of the head, you wanna make sure that you have them either looking down and off to the side. So what I'll do, so let me loosen this. I'll usually put their head exactly where I want it. So I'll push them down and I'm gonna push them to the side. So pushing down and then to the side, that's gonna allow me to really get into the section as to where I want it. All right, now every time I go to paint, what I wanna make sure I'm doing is I'm going to comb. And when we're doing any of the hairlines, make sure you're combing straight up. And I'm gonna be holding right where I'm gonna stop. And I am working with the Power Painter. Because this girl has some medium to coarse hair and she can handle it. So I'm gonna come underneath and then we're just gonna start to load up. So what I mean by loading up is we're gonna start to just kind of load up all the color in a section, and we're not gonna load it up at the roots and we're not gonna load it up at the ends. We're gonna load it up right here just in the mid area, and then we're just gonna kind of walk it down. And see these little guys that are playing out here? Just bring them up. And soft hands. I am keeping my brush parallel and flat to the hair.
No, you can just talk to her.
Hey, mister.
Elliot wanted to talk to you.
Hi, Elliot.
Back up.
What are you doing?
What did you want to ask her?
You dropped Tinsley off at school? Great job.
But what were you gonna ask her? Don't remember.
Oh. All right, as you guys can see right here, I have these like little bumps and they're not coming down. So I'm just gonna take the tail of my comb and then scissor fingers. And then we're gonna load up. We're gonna do in the mid area, load up that collar. I'm keeping tight tension. One thing I do love about the Power Painter is it's really gonna blend for you once you get up to the root. Walk it up to the root, Walk it up, walk it up. And when you're painting, I like to say, paint like you do when you do an updo. So my hand, the only hand that's being abrasive is that holding hand down there. Let me move it back. Okay, so now I'm gonna tip out her ends. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna place the board underneath, just like so. And I'm gonna load up my brush. Now I'm gonna put a lot of product on it right now, okay? It's a lot of product compared to what I was doing when I was building it up. So build it up, get it all on there. And then what you're gonna do is slowly move that board down, bring it back up, load up my product again, saturate it up through here, and then slowly guide it through. Now, when you take a board and you guide it underneath, not guide it, glide it like that, it's gonna help with blending underneath as well. All right, so now I'm gonna try to lift up this big old board without hitting my camera. So we're gonna take it. And now what you can do is you can lift up the color and you can make sure that it's fully saturated all the way down and through. And it is. So that's how you're gonna paint the backside towel over here. And when you're working on a client with the backside and you're painting color or lightener, best way to keep them protected, get your little foil, grab the ends. I don't like working with gloves, so don't judge me, guys. I'm usually a really, really clean colorist when I do paint, so don't have to worry about it too much. And then I'm gonna show you guys this cool foil. So whenever I see the lines along here, that's not gonna fit there. So I like to make my foils fit where I'm sectioning and parting. So that's gonna be how I fold that guy. And I'm gonna place it right here. And that's just gonna protect it from everything as I'm working, okay? All right, so now we're going to drop that down. Now, when you're doing the back too, you could do several more just like that. You don't have to paint both sides. The first section in the back hairline is the only one that you need to paint the double side. The next you can just surface paint on your way up. Right. So now we're going to do the front hairline where I was showing you guys. So we're going to change her head position. We're going to put her head up and then I will stand in front when I'm first getting the underneath. This is the only time I'm going to stand in the front. So let me get this close. And I always tell them that I'm going to get in their personal space and I'm going to be all up in their face when I'm doing this section because I really do get up there. Now I'm re-clipping this because see how it was kind of hanging like that? I don't want anything hanging or touching down below. So I wanna make sure at all times I'm keeping this out of the way. Now, when you're working and you have colored the other side and you don't want this to touch the other stuff, you can simply lay a foil on the other side. So where you lay your hair, it won't get touched at all. All right, here comes the underneath. I almost always paint underneath on all of my beauties because when they wear their hair up, this is gonna make sure that it's nice and bright, whether it's lightener or color. I'm gonna make sure I'm painting up and underneath. So when I'm loading up and I'm painting, I wanna show you guys. So it's gotten messy, but you can see that there's not a ton of product and I'm loading it on one side only, okay? So what I'm gonna, let me get this guy smooth. And I'm over directing it back slightly, okay? So now I'm gonna reload up my brush, make sure it's nice and clean. We're gonna come in and get that motion going. Keep that motion, do not get stiff. That is the important thing about with painting is just to keep that motion going and get underneath here. And if you're having a hard time when you get in above the ear, then I'll sometimes just push their head away from me a little bit. And that'll allow me to get in a little bit better. All right, so I'm stopping right about here. Now, also make sure visually when you're putting your board underneath, this is about how far out you need to go. So here comes the scary part to some people. So here's an option you can do. You can take cotton and place it underneath if you want to, or let me make sure you guys can see this full effect of me pulling down. I am pulling down like so. So you can see that it's painted right there and I'm over directing back. So I'm gonna go back in with my color brush and I have a nice little bead right there. I'm gonna load up right here in the middle. And then repainting right here up in the front area is going to be super important, because that's where they're going to see the color. So having that color painted up towards that area is super important. Now, something different with painting with color versus lightener is with color, you don't have to make sure it's on super, super thick, because with lightener, the more you see, the brighter it will be. That's my philosophy. So with color, just make sure that, you know, when you're painting through that you can see everything. So now I'm going to go through. Let me back this guy out so you guys can see my big old board once I get in here. So I'm going to take this board. I'm going to place it underneath. There we go. And then I'm going to load up my brush. And I'm going to saturate. Load up even more on there. And I am really taking advantage of all the bristles and how thick this brush is to help load up those ends. And then just glide it. So as I'm gliding, it's going to automatically underneath start to blend all that color underneath for you. I love tipping out, especially on the Alex, everything. Now, tipping out means I'm fully saturating the front and the back of the section. Since it is such a natural technique, it's going to help give that pop. So you lift it up. You guys can't see too well, so I'm going to lift it up, check the underneath. It looks good. Set it down. Okay, now if I want to make sure I am protecting the hair and I'm nervous that when I drop down this next section, I'm scared to get color on it, let me show you how I'll fold this foil. So we're going to grab the foil. And remember, this four diagonals, so I'm going to make this mimic it, okay? So it's mimicking that part right there. We're going to place it right here. And what I like to do is don't push it on there, just tickle it. I do that with lightener too. Just tickle it with your hands just enough so it's on there, okay? Now we're going to keep making sure that we just work in a forward diagonal back section. Handle as much hair as you can. You can also, a fun way to mix this up too, is you don't have to use just one formula. You can have multiple formulas. I sometimes will even, I'll have lightener and one full panel, the next panel will be my color. That is the beauty with Ruskin 10, because they will not get black on you and will not get dark on you. If I'm doing the Alex and I'm just using color, sometimes I'll mix up a copper with it, especially with it being fall right now. That's a fun one to do. Okay, so now I'm going to subdivide this section. Remember, you guys, we're going to paint the back first. Now, something cool when you're painting this one first, so I can either full surface paint here, or I can make sure I can get in front of here, just like we do the front hairline. Visually, what is that going to create? If I'm painting this whole bit right here, and then this front, this whole bit right there, it's creating like a connected ribbon, a soft ribbon, but it's going to create a ribbon. So we're going to over direct, change my camera for you guys. And I'm always combing, always combing, because I want this smooth, keeping that tight tension. Also, when I'm right here where I'm holding, make sure it's not like that. Keep it flat, that flat, 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 flat. If you condense it and have it bulked up, that's where you're going to get all the smudges. So we're going to come through, load up this section. I want to get underneath here and see how over-directing back allows me to get into this area, where if I had it straight down, it wouldn't allow me to. So now I'm going to keep painting. We're doing full panels. So like I said, a full panel is when you're fully painting this entire section, AKA panel. So now that we have that done, I'm going to tip out the ends. Now, so what makes this an express technique? So first of all, I'm not going back and forth on the head. I'm doing one side, then the other. And when I'm not being a chatterbox showing you guys how to do this, I can literally get this full head on in 15 minutes. Okay. 15 minutes. Usually to have a luxury technique like this, it's going to take you hours. And then by the time I clean my color bowls and I get everything situated, it's time to rinse her. And specifically Alex, she was like, oh my gosh, this is so fast. She's like, she misses her conversations with me, but when Alex comes in, She is on her laptop working the entire time. So me being able to get her in and out of here with a luxury service, like, that's mind-boggling. How many of you have been able to get a client in and out in an hour doing a balayage? I wasn't able to until I had my rescue time. So I'm just keeping everything directed back on here, and then we're going to tip out. Now I'm going to show you guys, when I do this technique, I do not use the foils to protect. I do not have any issue with the color transferring onto the section above it. I will use the foil or cotton on the first one. By not using foil or anything to conduct when you're using color is ideal. That's also going to cut out on your time as well. Okay, I'm going to readjust her head so you guys can see a little bit closer and the top part. And when you drop this down, see how I drop those tips forward and not back onto that? And then my next tip is, when you're clipping this up and away, make sure you're clipping over, and I'm going to keep this horizontal and clip away. Okay, so now I'm going to tilt her so you guys have a better image of what I'm doing so you can see the top. Okay, this is going to be my longest and widest section because we're literally from front hairline all the way back to the crown. If you took all of this into one section and you painted this all as one panel, you're going to get splotches. So make sure to let the hair subdivide. I want it to go right there. Okay.
So Katie, remember, question for you.
Yeah.
Are you fully saturating only the ends, or are you doing it all the way up?
So I'm fully saturating from root to end, and then I'm tipping out at the mid ends. If that makes sense. So I'm going to come through and I'm fully saturating right here at all the root area. I'm doing a full panel. So everything at the roots is getting covered right now. I'm not fully saturating all the way to the bottom because this bottom underneath, that's what's going to give me some depth and dimension and a different color variety. Now, once I get to the ends down through here, this is where I'm going to fully saturate my ends. And I rotate with how far I go down with my ends every time. I'm not going to do the exact same amount on every end. So this guy is just kind of like the very tippy ends right here. This is going to help with giving that gradient blend, and you're not going to get any harsh lines. Do you have to tip out everything? No, you don't. You can just fully surface and then call it a day and then just keep on going. And then now we're going to get to the front. Now the front, make sure that we're over directing back. I want to get up here close for you guys so you can see. Sorry if I'm making you dizzy. Okay. So here's the front. We're going to make sure that we're going to comb this flat. And what I'm going to make sure I do is I want to paint and get right in there and paint it all the way back. And I'm going to slowly drop it and paint the top surface.
Hello.
Now, as I'm looking right here, I don't like, see there's that hair, it's touching. It's going to be hard for me to get in there with my paintbrush. So I'm going to drop this forward. I'm going to re-come through. So as you're sectioning and working through, beware of what's above that section because you do not want them to play. This is not the time for those sections to play. So see how I move that out of the way? I can get in here a lot better. You're also going to deal with flyaways and little guys like that. Don't overthink it. You can just get in there and paint them and it'll be just fine. So I'm going to switch it up a little bit when I'm getting right here into the front hairline. Let me grab them. So especially when I'm getting up into here in these tight spaces, I will grab a detail brush. These detail brushes are smaller. They will get in here and I won't have that bulky power painter going through here. So, and you, then I will switch my brush. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna load up. This is a great visual for you guys. So see the tip, the bottom side does not have any on it. It looks like it, but it doesn't. I just have a nice bead up across the top. I'm over directing back and I'm gonna come through and just swipe, swipe, swipe and get in there. Okay, now that I've done that and I've gotten that area on her, I'm gonna go back to my power painter and I'm going to power paint, and I'm going to go all the way up to the root, all the way up. And I'm just really making sure that all of this gets saturated. Now, another important part that you're seeing is my elevation. I'm coming directly straight out from her head. This is allowing me to get closer to the roots. I'm going to drop my elevation, and I'll show you guys how that does change it. So I do drop my elevation when I'm doing my mids and ends. So I move that. We're doing our scissor fingers. We're keeping it nice and smooth. So when the elevation is lower, this is when we paint the mids and ends. When you're wanting to do a full panel and you're wanting to get those roots, having it come straight out from the head is going to allow you to get in there much, much tighter and closer to that root. Because I know a lot of people complain that balayage or hand painting is too rooted. Well, if you have the right elevation and you get that saturation up there, you will not have that issue. So since I'm painting with color, it's a soft, soft technique. I need to make sure that I'm truly getting in there and I'm getting as close as I can to that root so we can see that brightness coming out from the root. All right, so now we're gonna come down to the next section. And I'm just gonna kind of visually show you guys too what I mean when I'm talking about the elevation and how it'll change how you can get in there. So we're forward back. We're gonna drop that guy down. All right. So I'm gonna get into the front and I'm gonna show you guys this with the elevation, okay? So when I have a low elevation like this and I'm painting, it's harder to get up into that root area. And also you guys can see it's not transferring. See that color? I had it on top, it's not gonna transfer. Okay, so then when I'm wanting to make sure I get close to that root, even when I get to the tip top of the head, sometimes I'll bring it straight up because it allows you to really get in there and get to that root. Versus when it's down, it's harder because A, you don't want to get color all over this side and it doesn't allow you to build that color right there, okay? So when you're working on the roots, make sure you either have it straight out 90 degrees from the head or raise up your elevation. And then once I go to paint the mids and ends, I'm going to slowly lower my elevation, get my scissor fingers, keep it smooth and bring it low. So that's something that's not talked about a lot is elevation when you're painting. So make sure you're just keeping an eye on your elevation when you are painting. So now we're gonna come through and the section already divided itself. Use your tail to just grab off hair and remove it off. Instead of your fingers, it'll make life much easier. So now we're getting into the crown where it's starting to round the head. So I'm having hair that's reaching all the way over here. If you're nervous about it splotching, subdivide it more. What I think I'm going to do is I'm just going to overdirect it even more backwards since we've been creating the ribbon effect on it. So I'm going to take my power painter, load it up in the mid area, come through here and paint it. And then once I get that side painted, I'm going to work my brush over, walk it, load it up. Now, when I'm working with lightener and doing this application, loading up is super important because once you load up right here, you can use that product to diffuse and paint and feather out, and you don't have to worry about it. So then we're gonna come through here, we're gonna paint the mids and ends, we're gonna grab my board and we're gonna tip out the ends. Now, if you get any mistakes or any color, or some people call them holidays with foils, AKA, see a little bit of color right there? So that color, this section wasn't clipped up where it needed to be. Just wipe it really quickly. It's 10 minute color, so be aware of that one. And that means that next time I need to make sure it's really clipped over. And once again, if you have color on the other side, have a foil over there and that'll allow you to really get it. So keeping that clip pushed away, not twisting the hair, keeping it flat and your clip horizontal. All right, so now I'm gonna grab her front hairline. I'm gonna make sure I grab any of these bad boys from underneath. And then I'm gonna over direct it back. I'm gonna grab my small detail brush to get that front hairline. And I'm gonna detail it out right here. Paint, paint, paint. And don't drop your section down or move on until it looks nice and blended. It's like when you're doing your makeup, you wanna make sure that it's nice and blended before you move on. So now I'm gonna load up here, keeping my elevation straight out from the head. And when you have these little hairs that want to play, just correct them, grab them, make sure you're very aware of everything and what you're doing. That way we can prevent any splotches, any uh-ohs, because that is what I hear with painting. People's biggest struggles is splotchiness and issues with the consistency. So I'm lowering my elevation. I'm using my scissor fingers. Now I'm going to just show you guys, if I weren't to tip it out, what it would look like. So I'm just going to surface paint this whole entire top section. We're doing a full panel. Generally, I always, if for tipping out, I will always do the front ones if I'm not going to do the back ones. That'll give you a different look as well. So visually, just know where you're at and where you're painting is going to create different looks. All right, so now we're at the last section. I'm going to drop it down. This is the biggest section. Make sure this guy's pushed over. Let me pull it back. Okay. So now I'm going to push, push. That hair wants to live there. Let it live there. Okay, push, push. That hair wants to live there. Let it live there. And then we'll paint this separately. So now it's subdivided into many sections, but I'm not having to work through several sections with it. So now we're going to come, we got these guys, push them out of the way, grab this guy. Now that we're in the crown area, you just need to make sure you're really aware of where all this hair is. Now, I don't like how it's wanting to play right there. So I'm literally just going to grab it and clip it away. And that, like you guys see, it's very important to just keep clipping that hair away. We're not resectioning, just clipping it away. And this is a pretty small section right here. So I'm going to grab my detail brush, because it is a dainty section and I don't want to overwhelm it with color. So I'm going to pull it and over direct it back, and I'm going to paint the surface. That's all we're doing, especially up at the roots, is painting the surface. Come through. Any question, you guys? Can you guys see everything good? I can see if you guys put anything up in the chat. So now we're going to drop down. This guy, back it up. Once again, we're wanting to make sure you guys can really see the elevation right here. It's coming directly out, and then I'm gonna lower it again. Even when I'm hand painting with lightener, this is how I keep my elevation and what I always am aware of. I'm gonna come through, I'm gonna get my power painter loaded up. See how there's bumps? I don't like those bumps. I wanna make sure everything is nice and smooth. I'm gonna come through, load it up, walk up my color. And I'm not on this top section wanting to paint the front right here. I'm wanting to make sure she just has a nice softness to that area. So I'm just doing a beautiful surface paint and then walking it down. And then you see I'm lowering down my elevation. Let me turn it. I'm lowering my elevation as I'm coming down on her ends. We'll tip out these ends. And voila. Now we're almost to the last little piece right here. So I'm going to get right in front of her for you guys so you can see this. Okay. So now we're going to take this piece. We're going to make sure that we comb it nice and flat. We get all the little guys out of it. And we're going to get our scissor fingers, hold it nice and smooth. I'm over directing it slightly back. Now this part, you're going to want to make sure you get right up there, and then we're going to ribbon it out. So I'm going to use my detail brush for this one. I'm going to put just a little bit of a bead on it. Come right here. Don't go straight to the root, because if you have too much product on your brush, it's gonna give you splotchiness. And I'm just softly, 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 softly painting that. And then see underneath here, there's like a little bead. Just swoosh it, just swoosh. Keep an eye on everything that you're doing so everything is nice and soft. And then, because I have her head tilted, we still wanna keep up that elevation. I'm still keeping my detail brush in my hand. And this is a really good image. You guys can see how my brush is flat and parallel. I am not pushing it in and going like that. You want to keep it flat to the hair, keep your tight tension, and watch your elevation. Now I'm going to lower it. So we're going to do my scissor fingers. Get it over here. There we go. Okay. So this is the last one. So scissor fingers, make sure everything is smooth. And I'm just going to work with the detail brush. It's in my hand. It's a smaller section. I'm not too worried about it. Grab your board. This one I'm going to switch out and grab my power painter because I want those ends to be nice and bright. So now I'm going to power paint down onto my ends and then slightly drop it down. Okay. Let me wipe off my hands and then I'm going to give you guys a full view of what I just painted. All right. So you can see when I get to the other side, I would want to make sure I mimic what I'm seeing here and then come all the way down. And now I'm going to turn it around. Okay. Oh my gosh, it almost touched my hair. Tight space. All right. Now I'm going to get it up close and I'm going to show you guys a good view of what the other side of her head looked like. They got painted. So let me fix this. Put her head up and then I'll get nice and close for you guys to see it. There we go. Okay. So what you can see right here is the color that I did yesterday on her. And I'll pull the phone off so you guys can see a little bit better. Bear with me. Okay. So you can see that it's not stripey, but you see that color and that iridescence that's going through and that red. And it's got a hint of that coolness, but it's still super bright. And when it grows out, it's gonna be super soft. And it goes all the way back to the crown area. Let me make sure I flip it around so you guys can see exactly everything that I'm seeing. Okay, there we go. Now I can see it all. Okay. And you just see that softness just going through at that hairline. It's nice and bright. I got the underside of this guy. You can see that's bright. It's soft. Like I told you guys, it's soft, but it's going to add that depth, that dimension, and that color that you want. When you have that client that is very particular and doesn't want anything crazy, but it's going to pop in just enough.
Yeah. Need a wipe? Okay. No. Not yet.
All right, you guys. Remove her out of the way. We'll do some finishing up. Now that I did everything, walked you guys through it all, why do you have me here? Any questions that you want to put down in the chat? Put down in the chat and I would love to answer. If I went over everything, then that makes me super happy. No questions. All right. So today, once again, I showed you the Alex technique. This technique you can use with Ruskin 10. You can do, I just typed one, it might have glitched. Yeah, retype it. I didn't see it pop up. Thank you. So I did the Alex with the Ruskin 10, the head sheet pattern. We will have that to you guys. I believe I sent it to Ashley. You'll have access to that. And this is going to cut down time. This is going to allow you to have luxury services. Even if you use the same pattern with just lightener, that is going to cut down time, but pair it with that 10 minute color and it's going to be game changer for you, especially if you're in a time crunch. I charge hourly and I can get her in and out in about 1 hour. That's even curling and cutting her hair. Just really think outside. Let's see. So for Alex, your guest, you do this regularly. So what is the possibility for non-virgin hair? What questions do you ask typically? Okay. So if this is for someone who has non-virgin hair, you want to play within the color realm that they're in. So say you've been putting on a level 5 on their hair and they're not wanting to use lightener on it, use a level 5, but change up your formulas, whether it's a 5, like gold, ash, like whatever you want to formulate it, make it a 5 or darker, and you can create that variation. If you're wanting to have brighter, then what I would recommend is go through with this same pattern, hand paint it with the lightener, and you can tone with the 10 minute color, knowing that they have permanent color all over their head. And that 10 minute color, it's not going to mess with any of those other colors. Or you could use the Express. Didn't go over that one today. That's a whole different one. The Express gloss is only a 5-minute gloss. So you could use the same pattern that I just showed you for the Alex technique with the lightener. And then you could use one of the 5-minute glosses. There's a level 6, 7, and 9, and you can play and mix all the, they have a VRPN for 7 and then NW for 6. Gives you a big variation so you can cut down on that time as well. So that was a really good question. So yeah. I hope you guys enjoyed this. Have fun with it. If you have questions or want to talk to me one-on-one, because I know it can be sometimes hard via Zoom since you're not in a classroom setting, feel free to message me on my Instagram. And I believe all of you guys follow me, KTB Hair. I can walk you through if you're going to do this on a guest, do it on a guest for the first time that you're confident with. If you are not a strong painter, that's okay. Get out a mannequin. Paint. Being on the mannequin and doing this sort of technique is going to get you comfortable. I feel like a lot of people, they just get stiff. They get scared. It's a scary thing. So just practice, have fun. And I have so many other techniques I can't wait to share with you guys. And I have had a beautiful Monday with all of you. Anything to end it, Ashley? Or are we good?
I think everybody's saying thank you and they loved it. It's amazing. I learned something. I think everybody on here could say they Yay! Did. So thank you so much, Katie, for your time. Where can they look to see the after if I missed that?
Yes. So I have the after on the mannequin that I showed them.
Yeah.
And then on the after, if you go onto my Instagram, KTB Hair, any of all of my posts that I do in the caption, it'll say either like the summer, the Jaren. If you see one that says the Alex, that is the after of what I taught you guys today. I have one that I just did recently. Her red hair is gorgeous. Like she's got really long hair. I did 2 different formulas on that one. And it really just shows off the technique with that. So you can find that on my Instagram page.
Awesome. Thank you guys. Here, I'm going to put her just in case. I'm sure you're all following her, but just in case you're not, it's in the chat. Thank you everybody so much. We're going to follow up. We have all your email because you're registered. We'll follow up with an email with some exciting things to look forward to. And as well as just some step-by-step, some things that you can utilize from what you learned today.
Absolutely. Because I want to make sure that everything that you guys learned today, it's friendly behind the chair. So I want you to profit, use it, have fun with it. So we'll have that full breakdown of everything.
Thank awesome. You, everybody.
Thank you. Everyone have a good Monday and a good start to your week.
Thanks so much, Katie.
Bye.